Hello everyone, we are from group 9 and today we're gonna present about semantics, the meaning of language. Before we start it, let us introduce ourselves. First of all, my name is Marsanda Savanabila and my student number is 103.
My name is Sabia Fasia and my number is 104.
My name is Bonita Laraswati Wicaksono and my student number is 109.
And my name is Adinda Zara Salsabila, and my student number is 110.
Okay, the first topic is about lexical semantics. It is the branch of semantics that deals with the meaning of words. The first is the referential. It is the meaning of an utterance describes the referent, an action, or a state of being. The first statement is your dog is barking. Some words have an actual concrete item or concept that the word refers to. It's referent. The referential meaning of a word is its definition. And the second one is a dog is a good pet for a family with children. In this sentence, the referent for dog is the concept of a typical dog, the mental image that the typical English speaker has in mind when the word dog is spoken. Next is sense. Sense is the extended meaning of a word or phrase that clarifies the referent. Abstract concepts such as love, truth, and justice do not have concrete referent. They are meaningful to English speakers because we understand their which is an additional meaning beyond referential meaning. Sense also allows us to understand the distinction between two phrases that have the same concept difference. For the example, there is a statement, Dr. Eisenlauer is our resident archaeologist. What the phrase Dr. Eisenlauer and the phrase our resident archaeologist refer to the same person. The second is words that do not have a referent but instead express relationships or characteristics. The example of the statement is he is the teacher of the class. The words he, teacher, and class in this sentence have concrete reference. Meanwhile, the words is the and of are words that have no referent and conjure up no mental image. The last is shifting referent, referents that are different for each speaker and each, like pronouns. The example is he is a teacher of class, he was the teacher of a class, he is the teacher of a class, he teacher of a class.
The next is semantic properties of words. Semantic properties are the components of meanings of words. One of the ways in which the meaning of a word can be analyzed is by determining its semantic properties. These properties are the elements of meaning that make up the mental image of the word in the mind of the speaker. For the example, the semantic property human can be found in many words such as parent, doctor, baby, professor, widow, aunt, and uncle. Next, this is the another example. The words man and boy can be the referent for the pronoun he because all of these words have semantic properties in common. The semantic properties are maleness and humanness. Consider the other semantic properties of each word. So this could be written like this. The semantic properties of a word are often analyzed by using a system of plus and minus. In the part of male and human, these two words got plus, but in the adult option, the word of boy got minus, because a boy is a child. By analyzing the semantic properties, it becomes clear that the difference between the meanings of the two words is the individual's age or stage of life. Next.
Next, we have words that have shared semantic properties. So what Marcia already explained, semantic properties are the components of meaning of words. Words that share semantic properties can be considered as semantic domain. Semantic properties include animal objects, male, female, countable items, and non-countable items. To some extent, we can break down words into various semantic properties. Consider the semantic properties of the word tree. It is a plant that is tall, comparing to other plants, has a trunk, and is long life, comparing to other plants. The domain of trees includes such as oak, maple, ash, and birch. Distinctive feature analysis is the process of breaking the domain into its component parts. We use plus and minus system to determine other words that may belong in this domain. As you can see in here, the semantic property that distinguish pines and palms from the other tree is they don't have broad leaves. Other example is shark and tuna. They both share the properties of live in water, have fins, and eat fish.
The next material is markedness in semantics. Markedness is the concept that some words or morphemes are more common or usual than others. The members of a semantic domain that are more common are considered less marked. On the other hand, the more uncommon or unusual members of a domain are considered more marked. Markedness gives us an idea how the native speakers of a language think about their word. Next. For many Americans, the word slave is unmarked when it means African or black slaves. When the slave is another ethnicity, that ethnicity has to be specified, as in Hebrew slave or white slavery. Additionally, English has a bias toward males that is demonstrated by the fact that most often the unmarked, simple version of a word has the semantic property of maleness. To designate a female, the word has to alter. Look at the following words below. Next, the next material is markedness within a domain. Another way to show markedness within a domain is with a chart that places the more unmarked terms at the top and the more marked terms at the bottom. This kind of chart allows us to include various distinctions among terms. In the domain of trees, there are trees with broad leaves, needles, and fronds, but there are also fruit trees and flowering trees. These trees can be broken down into categories that are recognized by scientists as species and subspecies. To read the chart, you should start from top to bottom. The terms become more marked the farther down you go. The most marked term is the scientific name, which only refers to one species or subspecies. The chart will be shown in the next slide. Next. Another examples of markedness within a domain. In the domain of color, the most common, most unmarked colors are black and white. The primary colors are red, blue, and yellow, while the secondary colors are green, orange, and purple. And there are also many shades of these colors, such as powder blue, mint green, and hot pink. The more specific terms are the more marked terms. The words in line one are the most unmarked, most general, and most common. In line two are more marked, more specific, and more uncommon. And the words in line three are the most marked, most specific, and most uncommon in this representation. Next. So I guess that's all from our group presentation. We are looking forward to your feedback, comments, and questions in the forum discussion on Aula. Thank you.